So, Chris, let's start with you.
Sure.
You are Mr. Robotics, correct?
Yes.
And when you were 10 years old, how predictable was it that you might be going into robotics?
So I don't know about robotics, but I think, you know, engineering was pretty clear. I think, you know, I literally, on my parents' fridge right now, there's literally still a picture from when I was there with the sweater vest and the glasses with tape in the middle. So I think it was pretty preordained.
It wasn't Halloween.
It was not Halloween, yes. Sadly.
Yes.
No.
And you knew you wanted to go into engineering and technology. What first caught your eye then about robotics in particular?
So I actually didn't really think about robotics until I was finishing up my undergraduate degree. And I had an opportunity to go work in telecom. And I was walking around the engineering building, and I saw this poster with this robot crawling into a volcano. And I thought, you know, shit, that's awesome. you know, I could go, you know, deal with telecom stuff, or I could go do something cool and real. And I thought, you know, that's the thing to do.
Uh-huh. And what have you done since?
So I've been working with in robotics for, I don't know, 12, 13 years, something like that. I've been involved with a lot of vehicles that drive themselves and recently came to Google to lead the self-driving car project here.
Got it. And I understand you have a video that you can narrate for us a little bit.
Sure,
about
yeah.
the project. Let's see
so,
it.
So this is a video showing our car driving itself in and around the Bay Area in San Francisco. So if we could start it. Cool. So we've built a fleet of 7 self-driving Priuses. We take a Prius, put crap on it. We take it out on the road, and we have it drive around. So here's on the freeways. We can do surface roads. We, of course, do that in traffic. The sensors we have on the vehicle allow us to operate day and night.
Was that planned?
No.
Wow.
I'll tell you, that was an exciting moment. And the vehicles can do basically anything that a person can do. So they can see all the way around them. They can make lane changes. We can see pedestrians and track them. We can see traffic lights. And we have 360-degree perception around the vehicle. So we understand what traffic's doing in the neighborhood. The vehicles can drive at freeway speeds. They can do it precisely. So here we go through a toll booth. They can do it in urban areas. So this is a little resort town near San Francisco. All this is the car driving, so it's seeing the pedestrians, reasoning about them, moving around. This is Lombard Street. It's a very scenic place in San Francisco. It is also home to the dumbest pedestrians on Earth. They walk in with the traffic. It's amazing. The cars are able to do, you know, pretty much anything a person can. So here we are in a construction zone merging with other traffic, and then we're going to get back on the freeway here and have to deal with the fact that it's a short merge and there's traffic whizzing by at 70 miles an hour.
Does the car have an aggressiveness setting?
Doesn't yet, no.
Okay.
It's set to 11. And then, of course, you know, we do a lot of testing on the track as well. So we joke we're the Prius drifting team sometimes. So part of how it works is that we use some of the best maps in the world. So we've taken Google Maps and, you know, taken it to the next level. We have 15-centimeter resolution models of the world. And we have lane-level models of the world as well that kind of feed into the car how it drives. And then in real time, we take laser data from the vehicle, and we process about 1,500,000 measurements per second. And from that, we cluster out where people are, where other vehicles are, and are able to track them, bicycles and whatnot. We've also done some work with radar. So here, this is a radar like you might have in your expensive luxury car for adaptive cruise control. We've taken that, refined the algorithms, and then used that to make the thing work.
Incredible. So from your point of view, is the aim here just to deliver a really cool car that drives well, or is there a larger strategy afoot?
So you know, our goal at Google is to advance this technology. We think in the long term, this has got a tremendous societal benefit. So worldwide, there's something like 1.2 million people killed in traffic accidents each year. If you look at the utilization of automobiles through the day, it's about 3% in the developed world. So you buy a car, it sits there 97% of the time. By developing this technology, in the long term, we think we can reduce traffic accidents, we can give people back their time when they're driving, and we can make better uses of the resources we have.
Amazing.
Thank you.
And you started on the robotics team at Carnegie Mellon University.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit about the innovative environment and any differences between academia and corporate zone?
Sure. So I've worked at, you know, at Google and at Carnegie Mellon. Carnegie Mellon was fantastic. There's lots of brilliant people there. But it's a university, and so it's you know, somewhat resource constrained. When you come to Google, again, we have the same caliber or higher caliber people, and we you know, effectively have, you know, unlimited resources. So for an academic, it's magical.
So you're trying to recruit all your former fellow academics, at least the good ones?
Yes.
Amazing.
Thanks.